500 years ago, man started painting the ceiling of a building that has since become quite famous. In 1508, Michelangelo started painting the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, and 4 years later, he finally finished. In fact, inserted in your bulletin is a picture of the Sistine Chapel, and you can look at that as we get started here. But the ceiling depicts nine different scenes out of the book of Genesis. And we see prophets and patriarchs of the Old Testament and various Old Testament stories that are all depicted in painting. And it's quite a magnificent and powerful thing to behold as you look up at that ceiling and you see all of this work. And we are impressed by the results. What we don't think of so much is all the work and the time and the effort that Michelangelo poured into making that happen. I mean, consider, for instance, the fact that he didn't just go to the store and buy paint that he painted with. He made the paint himself. He built the scaffolding and moved it around to the various sections of the ceiling. His arms were extended above his body or above his head for hours at a time. Paint dripped into his eyes. I mean, he poured a lot of time and effort and life into this, his blood, sweat, and tears. And we don't really consider all of that as we look up at the results. We just look at, hey, this is a job well done. And then 25 years later, Michelangelo was commissioned for another project at the Sistine Chapel. This time he painted the Last Judgment of Christ on the huge wall at the front of the chapel behind the altar. And it depicts the second coming of Christ on Judgment Day as described in the book of Revelation chapter 20. And for 4 more years, beginning in 1536, 4 more years of his life was devoted to painting that picture on that front wall of that church. Michelangelo painted this magnificent scene with Christ at the center and all these groups of people clustered around him. And on the left side, you see the dead rising out of their graves, and they go up to the judgment seat of Christ. And those who proclaim him as Savior are judged righteous, and they live in eternity in heaven with Christ. And on the right side of the painting, you see those who were condemned by Christ, and they're being pulled down into hell by demons. And it's quite a magnificent scene that gets us stopping and thinking about, you know, our eternity and are we right with the Lord. But again, we look at that kind of a painting and we are impressed by the results, right? I mean, we just think about how it all ended. We don't think about all the time, effort, blood, sweat, and tears for 4 years that Michelangelo poured into that as he was painting the Last Judgment of Christ. Well, when we talk about finishing well, when we talk about the end result, in business, this is called the bottom line, isn't it? You know, the bottom line. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus calls the bottom line the fruit of a person's work. Now for us, this Sermon on the Mount series ends today in Matthew chapter 7, verses 15 through 23. 3 months ago, when we began this message series, The Life Jesus Calls You to Live, we started with the very last section of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount that comes after this passage we're looking at today. We commonly know this passage as the Wise and Foolish Builders. And we began with that because in Jesus' teaching of the Wise and Foolish Builders, he tells us where all this stuff he's talking about ends up. You are either building your life on the rock-solid Christ and the principles that he brings out in the Sermon on the Mount, or you are building your life on the sand, meaning that you are ignoring his principles and you are not living according to Christ's ways, and that will end in disaster. This last major section in the Sermon on the Mount that we're looking at today, for me, is the most haunting and disconcerting piece in his whole message. Jesus talks about how he keeps score. And I'm going to be frank with you, it's a little bit scary to think about. In fact, we talked about this in Craig's Life Group last Sunday night. The fact that Jesus keeps score. And it's not when he talks about the wolves that's scary. You know, he starts out this section talking about how some people are like wolves in sheep's clothing. And it's not that part that scares me so much. The fact that there are these people who are hypocritical and they're two-faced and, you know, they appear to be holy in one sense, but they're very unholy in what they do, and they really hurt people and they abuse people and they undermine people in the end. And there are all sorts of people doing all kinds of things in the name of Jesus Christ that don't represent him very well. There are people who try to push their power over on other people and take advantage of them. There are people trying to get other people's money, and they talk a good game, but they're nothing but ferocious wolves seeking to control and devour and destroy other people's lives. They don't care. They're in it for themselves. They appear holy, but they're not. And it's hard to overestimate how much damage such people have done to the cause of Christ and the church over the years. I mean, think about it. You can have 100 Christians all doing things perfectly. You can have 100 Christians honoring Jesus with their lives, but it just takes one person to come along and destroy all of what they've done, all combined together. It takes one person who, as other people look at the church, they deem and conclude that all the church is hypocritical, all the church is two-faced because of what one person did. Maybe you can think of TV evangelists, you know, and we know of TV evangelists over the years who it seems like all they want is your dollar, right? Touch the screen, you'll be saved. Send us your $20 and we'll say a prayer for you. And so there are people like that are hypocritical and they appear holy, but they're not. And certainly we have to look out for those kinds of folks. They need to be exposed. And we know that not everybody who claims to be from Christ is, and we know that not everybody who claims to do things in the name of Christ really represents him well. And that's terrible stuff, but for me, more haunting than even that in this passage that we're looking at today, in Matthew 7, verses 15 through 23, turn there if you're not there yet, is when Jesus says that there will be people who do miracles, and there will be people who prophesy in his name, and there will be people who drive out demons in the name of Jesus, but then Jesus looks at them and he says, I never knew you. I never knew you. And there's this group of people who they're gonna come back with, but Jesus, we prophesied in your name. But Jesus, we did miracles. But Jesus, we drove out demons in your name. Doesn't that count for something? We did all kinds of neat things in your name. And Jesus is going to look them square in the eyes and he's going to say, I never knew you. Now, I don't know if these people are hypocrites or if they are people who really are serious followers of Jesus, but maybe over time they just kind of lost track of what was important to Jesus. And it's really scary to think that Jesus could say this to me. I never knew you. And, I mean, I would never want that to happen, would you? I would never want Jesus to look at me and say, depart from me, I never knew you. But thank goodness Jesus tells us how to avoid such a response. And we see that here in this passage of Scripture in his Sermon on the Mount. And this is where we see how Jesus keeps score. And so as people of God, we get the inside scoop here when we open up his word and read it. He keeps score by using the image of fruit. The image of fruit of all things. I know of one guy who said, I don't like it that Jesus' scorecard includes fruit and trees because I am no good with plants. He said, when I walk into the greenhouse section of a store, all the plants look at me and start screaming, get away from me, I'm too young to die. At least that's how he felt. But you know, here's the thing. I think you'll be okay with Jesus' teaching here, even if you're not good with plants. As he talks about fruit and trees. We're going to look at Jesus' scorecard as he brings it out in verses 15 through 23 of Matthew 7. And I think we can get this. There are basically three sections on Jesus' scorecard. Three sections that Jesus looks at in our life. And the first section is this. Good trees bear good fruit. Bad trees bear bad fruit. That's the first section that Jesus looks at. In other words, if you go out and you buy quality seed for an apple tree, and you plant it in the ground and it starts growing and you nurture that seed, you don't expect to harvest bad apples later on. Nor do you expect to harvest something other than apples if it's an apple tree, right? You don't expect to go to an apple tree and pick off an orange. I mean, that's just not how it works. And so Jesus says good trees bear good fruit and bad trees bear bad fruit. And you will know those ferocious wolves by their fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. And here's what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 7, verses 15 through 17. He says, "Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them." Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. So Jesus is pretty clear there about what we can expect from various kinds of trees. He's talking about how to keep score. How do we know what the score is in our life? And here's the thing. Jesus doesn't keep score exactly the way I do. You see, if I saw somebody truly do a miracle, I would be impressed by that. If I saw somebody prophesying in Jesus' name and they are accurate in what they have to say about God and they maybe even predict something in the future and that comes true, whoa, you know what? That's impressive. Or if somebody casts out demons in Jesus' name, I mean, I would be scared because I saw the movie The Exorcist, right? That's scary stuff. But still, I'd be going, wow. This person must really be tied in to God somehow. Or how about if we get a little more personal? You know, Jesus, aren't you impressed by all the sermons that I preached and all the lessons that I've taught? Or how about all those prayers that I've prayed, Lord? That's got to count for something, right? Or what about, you know, I put my $20 in the offering plate every week. Well, I know that it doesn't really represent well what I earned, and I know that it doesn't really show much commitment to you like I thought it would, but still it counts for something, right? And then Jesus says, I'm not sure I know you. How could he say that after all I've done? I dedicated my life to serving you, Lord. I went to church every week, or I went to church once a month. That's 12 times a year, right? I went to church on the big days of the year, Christmas and Easter. I was there. Well, if I'm understanding the sermon right, Jesus keeps score in a totally different way. Good trees bear good fruit, and bad trees bear bad fruit. And if my life isn't showing the fruit of the Spirit, then that's just not going to cut it according to Jesus' scorecard. It's just not going to cut it. Well, there's a second section to Jesus' scorecard. And that is, how does your life measure up to the Sermon on the Mount? In other words, how does your life measure up to the teachings that Jesus gives us in the Sermon on the Mount? And I just wonder, could Jesus maybe be challenging you in ways that you've never been challenged before when you honestly compare your life to his teachings? You know, could he be saying, you know, what I want from you is for you to live a life that's free from stuff. I don't want you to be consumed with materialism and all this stuff. Could he be saying to you, oh, what I really want for you is to be a person who is full of integrity and honesty? Or perhaps he's saying to you, you know, what I really wanted was for you to be someone who loves other people relentlessly. Is there fruit that Jesus wants in your life that you're not producing? Are you a good tree producing good fruit, or are you a bad tree producing bad fruit? Jesus gives us the scorecard here. And in Matthew chapter 7, verses 18 through 20, this is what we read. Beginning with verse 18, a good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit, you will recognize them. I have a little confession to make here. When you pass the half century age mark, like I have, you start to look at life and wonder how you've done. Any of you who are older, can you relate to this? You start to look at life and wonder, how am I doing here? You know, what does the scorecard look like? How are you keeping score in your life? And I think we need to ask ourselves, is the way I'm keeping score the same way that Jesus keeps score? Because in my life, sometimes I might look at how big the church is, or how many sermons I've preached, or how many people I've baptized. Sometimes I might look at how nice the building is that we worship in, or how big is the annual budget. And here's the thing. If that's my scorecard, I can very easily get, you know, a little distracted, a little disappointed. I can feel like maybe I haven't done a whole lot. But if I look at the scorecard a little bit differently, how Jesus might look at it, maybe the way to look at the score is how many people around you are living out the Sermon on the Mount in their lives every day now compared to before. And, you know, maybe that's how Jesus keeps score. I think Jesus keeps score more in the sense of that last way that I mentioned. And so, are people being more loving? Are people living with more joy and peace in their life? Are they patient and kind and good to one another? In other words, are we united as a spiritual family? Are we united as a church family under the name of Christ? Do we do nice to one another? Are we courteous? Are we encouraging? Or are we just rude and bad-mouthing of each other? Or what about faithfulness? You know, are we bold and confident in sharing the gospel with others? Do we take a stand where God calls us to take a stand? Are we gentle? Do we have self-control in all of those areas of life where we need to be self-disciplined? You see, this last little teaching section in the Sermon on the Mount in some ways captures the essence of everything that Jesus has been saying in Matthew chapters 5 through 7, and it pulls it all together. And it says, if you want to know whether or not you are living the life Jesus calls you to live, you compare it to what we find in the Sermon on the Mount. I think it'd be a pretty good idea for us at the beginning of each month throughout this upcoming year to read through Jesus' Sermon on the Mount in its entirety, once a month, chapters 5 through 7, all in one sitting, just to see how we are measuring up to his teachings, and to remind yourself that this is your goal if you want to live the life that Jesus calls you to live. And so, by doing it at the beginning of the month, I could look at the previous month and I could say, how did I do in living out the Sermon on the Mount? And then, because it's at the beginning of the month, I can say, hey, you know what? Here's some goals for me to keep in mind if I want to be a kingdom person, if I want to be a Sermon on the Mount person. You can look at it as kind of a spiritual health checklist. What a great idea. I'm glad I thought of that. You know, there are healthy churches and there are sick ones. And every church's health is determined by the Christians who make up that congregation. There are healthy Christians and there are sick Christians. And Jesus gives us the full scorecard by which we can measure ourselves. How does your life measure up to the Sermon on the Mount? Here's the third section of Jesus' scorecard. Maintain sight of what Jesus really thinks is important. You see, these three sections of Jesus' scorecard, they are all connected. In order to do well in one area, you need to do well in the other two areas. So, to be a good tree that bears good fruit, you have to measure your life by the Sermon on the Mount. And if your life measures up to the Sermon on the Mount, and you are living out those teachings in your life daily, that is only possible if you are maintaining sight of what Jesus believes is really important. Or you could say it like this. Maintain sight of what's important to Jesus, and you will live out the teachings of the Sermon on the Mount. Your life will measure up to that, which will result in your life bearing good fruit. And if you lose sight of what's important to Jesus, you won't live out his teachings in the Sermon on the Mount, and your life will bear bad fruit. And that's bad for the church. You have to decide what kind of tree you want to be. Will you be a good tree bearing good fruit, or will you be a bad tree bearing bad fruit? And see, we have this independent kind of thinking in our culture today which says, you know, you just mind your own business. Don't try and tell me what to do. As long as what I'm doing is not hurting anybody, what's the matter? It doesn't affect anyone else. But that's just not true. What you say and what you do, it affects other people. It affects your family. It affects your friends. It affects your neighbors. It even affects your church. And so we have to keep in mind what Jesus thinks is really important. And he says, there's so many crazy things being said in the name of Jesus. We need to remind ourselves of this, don't we? And when you follow Jesus, it'll never lead you to hurt or abuse people or marginalize them or treat them rudely. When you follow Jesus, you will treat people with respect, you'll be kind and considerate, and you will show the fruit of the Spirit in your lives. And when we are hurtful towards people, when that happens, that's not just living your life badly, but that's the result of bad doctrine. That's the result of not maintaining sight of what Jesus really thinks is important. True teaching of Jesus and his life calls us to love other people. It embraces, it transforms, it never humiliates, it never abuses, it never puts down, it is not rude, it is not self-seeking. And that's why in Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 23, Jesus says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter into the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles?' And then I will tell them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers.'" Wow. What if I spent my whole life doing things that weren't really all as important to Jesus as they were to me? What if I said, "But Jesus, I preached sermons and I taught lessons and led Bible studies and I led life groups and I did all these wonderful works in your name"? What if you said something along the same lines, only you filled it in with the good works and the particulars for your life, the things that are important to you? You know, "I took care of my family. I washed my car and kept it nice. I worked hard. I tried my best to live by the Ten Commandments. You know, I went to church when I could." And what if Jesus then says, "I never knew you. What I was interested in is you living a life free of materialism and full of integrity and love. What I wanted was for you to live a life that was less angry and had a nicer attitude. What I wanted was for you to show a little more concern for me and to love what I love and hate what I hate. What I wanted for you was to live your life according to the Sermon on the Mount." I'm telling you, you better maintain sight of what Jesus really thinks is important. Otherwise, this world and our culture and people's opinions and your own misguided desires, they will pull you in 1,000 different directions. And that direction that you find yourself going in, it might not be the direction God wants you to go in. And we say, well, what's the matter? It doesn't matter what I do. It doesn't matter what I say. It doesn't matter what I invest my time, my treasures, and talents into. What's it matter? But then Jesus is going to look at you at the end of time as we know it, and he's going to say, "I never knew you." It'll matter then, won't it? It'll matter then. And the Sermon on the Mount is a full scorecard for life. It's the way that Jesus keeps score. And maybe you never thought of Jesus as keeping score before. But all these things we've been talking about throughout this 12-week message series, they are his bottom line. Make sure you don't spend your whole life pursuing all these other things that aren't as important to Jesus as they are to you. Make sure that you don't spend your whole entire life chasing after things that when all is said and done, it really doesn't amount to a whole lot and it doesn't make a difference. You see, Jesus tells us how we can win at this game called life. Don't be like the horse jockey who won his race much to the displeasure of his employer. Maybe you heard this story before. But there were two Kentucky farmers, and each of them owned racing stables. They loved to race horses, and they had some expensive racing horses. And these two farmers, they were friends with one another, but as the years went on, they became quite competitive against one another. And they were competing, and they were, a lot of times, they would tease one another. And one spring, they decided that they were going to enter their horses into the local steeplechase. Thinking that a professional rider might help him to outdo his friend, One of the farmers invested a ton of money into hiring a well-respected jockey. This jockey was well-known. He was known for winning races, and he was excited to have a professional jockey race his horse. He thought, this is how I'm gonna win against my old buddy over here. And they both anticipated winning the race. They thought their horses were gonna win, and the race was on. As the horses came out of the gate, everybody was even, but then these two horses of these two farmers started pulling ahead of the rest of the crowd, and they were jumping the fences, and they were jumping the ponds perfectly. And at the last fence, as they were getting ready to jump it, their two horses were the ones in the lead in this race, but it proved to be too much for them to handle. The horses stumbled, they fell, and both riders were unseated. But that calamity wasn't about to stop the professional jockey. He quickly remounted, he got on his horse, raced it to the finish line, and won the race. And as he triumphantly walked his horse back to the paddock, which is the area where they put the saddles on the horses and get them ready for the races, he was looking for the farmer who had hired him. He found that farmer, and he expected to be greeted excitedly and congratulated, but the farmer was fuming with rage. And the jockey asked him, he says, "What's the matter? I won, didn't I?" And the farmer roared back. He said, "You won all right, but you won the race on the wrong horse. And that's not really winning." There are many different horses in your life that you might ride. One of them is called success, but you know what? Too often he throws you off. And there are other horses too. Horses named envy or jealousy. Horses named anger or horses named wealth. And you might think, "Oh, I'm going to ride these horses, and for a while it's enjoyable," but they end up failing you too. And you end up flying through the air and landing on your butt. When it comes to your life, make sure you're riding the right horse. When it comes to your life, make sure you are scoring correctly. Jesus wants your life to be formed and to be lived according to the cross. The life that he calls you to live is a cross-shaped life. It is a life lived according to the Sermon on the Mount. And as our praise team comes up and gets ready to lead us in a closing song this morning, I just want to say that while many people spend their whole life climbing what they imagine to be a ladder of success, either at work or at play, or maybe it's at home or out in the community, Jesus calls us to climb the mountain with him and to be blessed. He calls us to climb the mountain with him and to be blessed, to live our lives according to the message of the Sermon on the Mount. And, you know, what does that mean? It means that we love him more. It means that we serve him. We live our lives to please God. And it's not that we don't care about success. It's not that we don't care about doing well in life. Of course we do. It's just that we define success and life differently than a lot of other people who don't follow Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. We seek to honor Christ with our life. That's how we define success. And that's how we define life. And so it's up to us to decide, how are we going to live? Are we going to apply these principles to our life? Or are we going to live for ourselves and be selfish? Are we going to live for Christ and be ushered into eternity? Or are we going to live for ourselves and be very disappointed? You see, we live not for the day when Jesus says to us, "I never knew you." We live for the day when he says, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Now, Jesus has showed you how to keep score. That was pig Latin, wasn't it? Jesus has shown you how to keep score, and he's showed you how to finish well. Now, go do it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you. We thank you that we can come to you and know that you love us no matter what. You love us even when we are disappointing, but you do not expect us to just stay where we are. You do not expect us to come into your presence and to worship you and to leave here being the same person that we were. Change us, change our hearts, that we might reflect you, that we might be transformed, that we might love others, and we might be bold in sharing the gospel message with them. We will be happy knowing that we are making you happy. May we go forth with your favor and your blessing. In Jesus' name we pray.